Tantor Audio presents Darksong Rising by L.E. Modesitt, Jr. Narrated by Amy Landon. 1. Anna readjusted her floppy brown hat and shifted her weight in the saddle. Beneath her, Farinelli, the big Palomino gelding, continued his quick walk eastward along the dusty road that ran south of the Cheon River toward the former ford at Sorprat. Anna glanced sideways at Hymar, the sandy-haired captain, over-captain now, whose mustache drooped more than usual, perhaps from the road dust, perhaps from sweat. Two of her personal guards flanked them, Rickle on her left, and beyond and slightly back of Hymar, Lejeune. An over-captain. Personal guards. Sometimes it was still too hard to believe that she was regent and sorceress of Defalk, and Lady of Mencia. Less than 2 years earlier, she had been Anna Marshall, struggling assistant professor of voice in Ames, Iowa, a divorcee mourning the death of her eldest daughter. Then a spell sung in Defalk, and her own ill-uttered wish to be anywhere but Ames, had thrown her into the intrigues and battles of Leetwar, both colored by the ever-present male chauvinism, a chauvinism that so often she seemed the only one to recognize, even after she'd survived 3 attempted rapes. Because the world of Erde was governed by the harmonies and song magic that worked, those struggles she faced were more deadly than the faculty politics of Ames. But only slightly, Anna reflected, as she thought of the fate of untenured and discarded junior faculty members at the universities where she had taught over the years. The late summer sun had burned the back of her neck, despite her ever-present felt hat, and the sweat that oozed from her hair added to the stinging. In her green trousers and shirt and floppy brown hat, she scarcely looked like a regent. Only the gold-trimmed purple vest betrayed the slightest indication of rank. That, and her position at the head of the column that stretched a good 100 yards behind her. An older-looking woman with red hair liberally streaked with white rode up alongside Hymar, clearing her throat to announce herself. Anna turned toward her chief player. Yes, Liende?
Lady, the players are tired, especially young Delvor.
Anna glanced at the road ahead, rising slowly to a crest perhaps a deck away, roughly a kilometer in earth terms, then back to Liende. I suspect all the armsmen are tired too, Anna temporized, blotting the sweat from her forehead. Everyone can rest a little when we get to Sorprat. I mean, this side of the river. I think it should only be 2 or 3 decks from here.
4 at the most, added Hymar.
It won't be that long, Anna promised. As you say, lady.
The woodwind player nodded, then let her mount drop back. The air was still, so hot that the browned grasses to the south of the road hung limply in the heat. Road dust coated the legs of the horses, and a finer film covered the rider's legs. Anna rubbed her nose, gently, wondering why she had ended up breathing so much road dust. Because there wasn't any other way? Hymar eased his mount closer to Anna, his eyes on the pair of scouts nearing the rise in the road almost a deck ahead.
I will be glad when you have completed this task, lady, the over-captain said in a low voice, and you can return to Falkor.
Anna nodded. Lord Jex would also be glad when she returned, since the white-haired and still young-faced Lord of Elheld had questioned the need for her mission, even though he was the grandfather of young Jim Bob, the heir to Defalk, for whom Anna ruled as regent. Regent for a youth not always grateful. Yet you've used your sorcery for Jim Bob, when you can't even use it to see your own children. She swallowed, her throat even drier than from road dust alone. Would she ever be able to use the mirrors and her song magic to see Elisabetta again? Or Mario?
Lord Jex was concerned about this task, Hymar added, unnecessarily.
The blonde-haired Rickle, head of her personal guard, smiled, if briefly, before the professional indifference again masked his amusement at Hymar's acknowledgement of Jex's protectiveness of the sorceress. Anna hadn't realized how much she missed Jax, but she'd insisted that he remain in Falkor to heal from his wounds. In their efforts to drive the Sturinese out of Dumar, to save Anna, he'd thrown himself into the enchanted javelin hurled by the Sea Priest of Sturin. She still wasn't sure that she would have been able to do something like that to save someone else, not the immediate and selfless way Jax had done to save her. She moistened her lips at the memory. Jax had not been happy with her decision to leave Falkor, especially for the 10 days it would take, and he had been quite forceful.
"I do not see why you insist on riding out to Sorprat. You do not need a ford there, not this year. What crops there are come from the lower valley, and the peasants and farmers can use the bridge at Palmer. For another year or so, there will be little enough trade with Ebra. What there is can take the old road on the south side of the Cheon River."
Except that the old road adds almost 2 days' travel to Mencha and Ebra, and you may need those days all too soon. In fact, her own journey to repair the ford was on the old road, and even pushing, it would take a day more. But she knew she needed to be on the south side to see what she could do to undo the mess she'd made of the ford when she'd created a giant sinkhole to swallow the Ebran invaders. And she felt that repairing the ford was necessary. She ignored solid gut feelings at her own peril, and the ford's destruction had been nagging at her for well over a year. As she rode across the high bluff on the south side of the river, Anna glanced to her left, northward, out across the river, across the green valley that, everywhere away from the irrigation ditches, had been brown and dusty little more than a year earlier. She did not look forward to revisiting the site of the battle with the Dark Monks of Ebra, except that it had been more of a slaughter than a battle. Even under the hot sun of late summer, she shivered, recalling the screams and the terrible grinding of the earth as her song sorcery had churned the muddy waters of the Cheon River over the trapped soldiers. The column crossed the low rise in the road and started on the gentle downgrade toward the point on the south bank of the river opposite the town of Sorprat, or what of it had been rebuilt after the destruction wrought by Anna's magic. It still astounded her that good, or harmonic song magic, clear song, could create such massive destruction, often with not too great a side effect on Anna. Yet the smallest of dark song spells, even those which would have obviated the need for destructive clear song, could prostrate her, possibly threaten her life. Another unfairness that you can do nothing about, because that's the way this world operates. Period. She put that thought aside and concentrated on the spell she would have to use shortly. Before long, she reined up Farinelli, short of where the high grassland ended, abruptly. Hymar gestured, and a trumpet signal echoed through the early afternoon. Behind them, the column slowed and halted. Anna patted Farinelli on the shoulder, and the gelding nodded ever so slightly, as if to suggest that he indeed deserved some thanks. Where the plateau ended, what had once been a sinkhole was now a circular and placid lake, smaller than it had been, and cut off from the Cheon River by a low muddy rise barely 3 yards above the lake's surface. The water was still brownish. Below the sorcery-cut bluffs, between the base of the bluffs and the water's edge, instead of beaches, mud slopes angled into the murky lake.
"It is peaceful now," said Hymar quietly. "One would hardly know that thousands perished there."
Anna nodded. 10,000 Ebrans. Dark monks, she added mentally. "We're close enough." Hymar turned his mount and stood in the stirrups.
"Stand down!"
As she thought about the Ebrans, Anna almost wanted to shake her head. Hadron, the Ebran lord of Synek, had beseeched her to accept his fealty. She had, and in making him one of the 33 lords of Defalk, thereby effectively added a quarter of Ebra to Defalk, and probably ensured another war in Ebra. One way or another, there would have been war in Ebra, she reminded herself, between Hadron and Bertman, the noble who had taken the title of Lord of Dolov and sought to unite all Ebra under his rule. The difference was that Hadron had a legitimate claim to lands that had been seized from his father, and sought only those lands, while Bertman was willing to sell out to the Leitfjord of Mansur and the Sturinese to rule all of Ebra. And the Sturinese chained their women. Anna dismounted. For a moment, as she grasped the cantle of the saddle with one hand, she wasn't sure if her legs would hold. After she took the bottle that still held water, she drank slowly. She recorked the bottle and replaced it in the holder before walking slowly in the open road before Farinelli to stretch her legs. Next came the vocalizes, to clear her cords of dust, and the mucus from allergies that Brill's youth spell had done nothing to remedy. Holly lolly pop. Behind her, horses sidestepped, and the armsmen murmured in voices so low that the sound was more like locusts than men. She shook her head, then began another vocalize, hoping that getting her cords clear would not take forever.
Quiet, snapped Hymar,
and the murmuring died away. When Anna felt her cords were clear, she walked back to the gelding and extracted from the left saddlebag the sketch of the ford she had drawn from memory back in Falkor. Once she unrolled it, her eyes flicked from the drawing to the terrain before her and back to the drawing, comparing the two. The sketch showed almost a wide and flat stone shelf-like structure that would spread the river into a shallow and wide expanse, similar to the clay flats and gravel shallows that had existed before Anna had destroyed the bend in her efforts to annihilate the Ebran forces. She'd also sketched out what amounted to a gradual spillway that would funnel the river back into the deeper channel that existed below where the ford had been. While she could have used sorcery to construct another bridge, the ford had worked before, and she was reluctant to change what had worked, especially since the northern side of the river was so much lower than the south, and there was little enough stone beneath the bluffs. Finally, Anna lowered the scroll, turned and motioned to Liende, who stood before the players. Anna waited until the red and white-haired woodwind player eased forward. If you would bring the players up here, face them toward the river, not the lake, the sorceress said. We'll use the long building spell. Warm up and run through it a few times while I finish getting ready. Players to position, here. Liende motioned for the others to gather in a semicircle. Anna walked forward a few steps, before stopping and looking at the sketch of the ford and attempting to reconcile it to the reality of crumbling bluffs and mudflats split by a turbid river perhaps 30 yards wide in a deep channel. While the fall corn, the woodwinds, and the strings tuned behind her, she sang the notes of the spell, using law instead of real words, and worked at visualizing the ford. We stand ready, Liende announced. Anna turned to the chief player. I'd like one run-through to fix the spell and words, please. At my mark, Liende ordered. Mark. Anna tried to mesh the visual image, the words, and the melody, all without actually singing the spell itself. Halfway through, she stopped and shook her head. I'm sorry, could we try that again? After the second run-through, Anna took another sip of water, squared her shoulders, and nodded once more at the chief player. The long building song, for the spell, commanded Liende. At my mark? Mark. Anna concentrated on just the spell, and the image of the stone-footed ford the spell was designed to form, ignoring the heat, ignoring the 50 armsmen mounted and ranked behind the players, using full opera voice to set the spell. Replicate the blocks and stones, place them in their proper zones, set them firm and set them square, weld them to their pattern there. Bring the rock and make it stone. The bluff underfoot shivered and kept shivering. Anna had to step sideways, but managed to keep her voice open, strong, and clear. The lightning marking her use of the harmonies, and unseen to any but her, or so it had seemed, flickered in the bright blue southern sky. The haze that formed would turn into clouds, clouds that would dissipate within a few hours. glasses, she corrected herself mentally. As the song ended and the shimmering haze lifted, Anna smiled raggedly. The bluff to her right had been trimmed into a stone-paved incline road down to the river, and the murky waters of the Cheon formed a glistening sheet nearly 100 yards wide across the newly created stone ford. On the far side, a second stone causeway rose out of the ford to join the road through the dozen huts that represented the rebuilding of Sorprat.
"Most amazing, Lady Anna," offered Hymar.
Murmurs from the armsmen ranked behind the players were louder.
"See? Not many others who can do that. Not many, Nerwait. How about none? Hope the peasants appreciate it."
The dizziness that accompanied strenuous song spell casting again left Anna lightheaded, but she stood firmly on the ground that shifted under her. Every spell she cast, or so it seemed, left her weak, if for varying periods. That she had to eat like a glutton to maintain her strength was something she still had trouble accepting. Rickle handed her the water bottle and a hard biscuit. Anna took both, murmuring, "Thank you." "Will you ever do a song spell without feeling drained?" Her eyes blurred, and she grasped at the saddle to steady herself, holding on until the dizziness subsided. The near dozen players stood drained, their shoulders drooping, as they also sought water and biscuits. Anna stepped toward them. "Thank you all." She had to make an extra effort to ensure her voice carried, that it was steady. She nodded to Liende and offered a smile. "Everyone was together."
"We have been practicing," Liende acknowledged, her eyes dark with fatigue.
"I can tell."
"Thank you."
Liende bowed slightly, and Anna took another swallow from her water bottle. Even after drinking and eating several biscuits, she remained lightheaded, and might until the next day. But she remounted Farinelli, offering a smile to Hymar.
"Shall we try the ford?"
"As you wish, Regent," responded the overcaptain gravely. "As you wish."
Once the column was remounted, Anna urged Farinelli toward the stone causeway that sloped down to the Cheon River, toward the ford only she thought was necessary. Was it really for faster travel to Mencia and Ibra? Or because you destroyed the old ford? To redress the wrongs your sorcery has created? Her gut feeling remained that she had done the right thing, but the uncertainty as to why remained. Long after the column had passed through Sorprat and the Cheon River sheeted near silently over the newly wrought stones of the ford. 2. Way Nordway. With the knock on the door, Ashtar sets aside the polished black agate oval and straightens herself behind the wide table of a counselor of Way.
"Enter."
Gretzlin bows as she enters, and again as she approaches the table where the dark-haired spy mistress waits. Ashtar nods toward the chair, but remains silent behind the table as the younger woman seats herself. After a moment of silence, Gretzlin begins to speak.
"As you requested, Your Mightiness, we have scried the waters of harmony and dissonance. Both the Sturinese and the Leetfjord are assisting Bertman's efforts to conquer the free women of Alawa. He is gathering barges at the River Quays on the south side of Dolav. 3 Sturinese ships are skirting the shoals of Discord now. Earlier, they anchored off the northern coast.
Has the Leetfjord sent any assistance in recent weeks?"
"The seers have found none."
"What of the sorceress?"
"The sorceress has sent some golds to Hadron, but neither armsmen nor arms. Hadron has sworn fealty to Defalk and the Regency. The sorceress did use Clearsong to repair the ford on the Cheon where she massacred the Ebrins. That will reduce the time of travel to the east of Defalk and to Ibra. She is returning to Falkor, but she has done nothing about the Dark Singer in Palmer. It is possible she does not know of his efforts, local as they are."
"And the Mater of Sturin?"
"The high forests of the Aust Isles are being cut to build more ships to replace those lost in Dumar," replies the blonde seer. Near on half a score already rise from the ways at Ular, and almost as many at Puerto Claro.
Has the situation changed in Nazaria?
The 50-score Mansuran Lancers remain in Isauria, but our sources indicate that they will soon be posted to Iliac. Even so, it is unlikely they will ride near the West Pass. No Nazarian Lancers or armsmen will accompany them.
Ashtar nods once. Watch Isauria and Alawa most closely.
Not the sorceress.
She has never moved without provocation, and you have told me how strained your seers are. Once there is provocation, then it will be time to watch her more closely.
Before Ashtar speaks again, Gretzlin asks, her voice deferential, Will the Council do anything to assist the free women?
Earlier, the Council sent food and tools to help rebuild Alawa from the floods loosed by the sorceress when she destroyed the Evolt. There may have been some weapons and golds in those ships, and it is possible that there could be additional assistance to the people of Alawa.
Ashtar's voice is level. It is possible, Gretzlin repeats, her voice equally level.
Do not press, Gretzlin.
Ashtar stands.
You may go.
3. The white and scattered puffy clouds of morning had thickened and darkened throughout the early afternoon, until a nearly unbroken stretch of gray filled the sky. A cool breeze blew out of the northeast and across eastern Defalk, fueled by the chill of the distant icy peaks of the Ostfells. Anna enjoyed the break from what had seemed a steamy and unending ride back from Sorprat toward Palmer. She'd been happy to pull off the floppy brown hat and let the light breeze blow through her neck-length hair, scarcely longer than that of some of the armsmen. Hair any longer than that was hardly suited to riding or washing in a half-medieval culture, and she had far more to worry about than her hair, like how to build an effective national army so that you don't have to resolve every border problem with song sorcery or the threat of it. The road through the green fields and the river valley were both flat, flatter even than Iowa, and the air was humid, despite the breeze. Even the road dust was heavier, coating only a span or two of the horse's legs.
Thrum!
The muted and distant thunder rolled out of the northeast.
We'll see rain before we reach Palmer.
Hymar glanced to Lejeune, the guard to his right, as if for confirmation. Anna studied the clouds for a moment, shifting in the saddle and absently patting Farinelli on the neck. A light rain, maybe not that much. She looked at Rickle, riding to her left.
You're from around here, aren't you? What do you think?
The broad-shouldered Rickle cocked his head, but his eyes continued to survey both the road and the waist-high bean plants that flanked the road behind the irrigation ditch, filled with muddy water.
I'm from Hainin, but I'd agree with you, Lady Anna. The clouds aren't dark enough, not by half.
Hainin? He doesn't look like one of the grassland riders. At the sound of a muted hail, all four looked westward along the dusty road.
That would be the messenger.
Hymar pointed toward the rider who neared after passing the scouts, riding nearly a deck ahead of the main column.
There's another rider with him, in blue livery.
I hope that Lady Gutrune is at home, Anna said.
You would be welcome even if she is not, pointed out the overcaptain.
That might be, but it would be less awkward if she is. And it would be seen as less of an imposition by the more hostile lords of the 33. The young-faced messenger reined up short of Anna and Hymar, as did the second rider. The grizzle-bearded older man wore the Prussian blue livery Anna recalled from when she had first met Lord Kaisar before the old lord had died at the Battle of the Sand Pass, before his consort Gutrun had taken over running his lands for their son and heir, before Anna had ever even thought about becoming a regent.
Regent, over-captain, offered the older armsman. The Lady Gutrun expects you and bids you welcome.
Anna concealed a frown. The armsman looked familiar.
She repressed a sigh. The name wouldn't come. Finally, she offered a smile. I should know you, armsman, but I'm tired, and your name escapes me.
Maris. I asked to come, Regent.
Maris. Anna could feel the broader smile with her recognition of the man. You were the one who made it easy for me to see Lady Gutrun after the Sand Pass battle, on my way to Falkor. It's good to see you. Maris beamed.
Thank you, Regent. Like I told Bayliss when you came to Palmer, I owe you my life for that.
Anna fumbled with the wallet at her belt, then extended a gold. Maris, I promised you once I wouldn't forget you. I couldn't recall your name, and you did a service that I couldn't repay you for then. Words are fine, but golds help with getting on with life. Maris took the gold, slowly.
Wouldn't as I came for that.
I know that, but when a regent promises... Anna offered another smile.
Thank you, lady. Thank you, and Annabelle will thank you, too.
He bobbed his head.
Like as she will, seeing as she said words like that often enough.
Maris offered a grin. Anna nodded at Maris, then Hymar. We'd better keep riding, or we will get caught in the rain, and so will the armsmen. Maris guided his mount into the column somewhere behind Anna, and beside the messenger as the force resumed the ride toward Palmer. Shoulder-high maize graced the fields ahead, still green in the late summer. Anna glanced at a hut, smoke circling from its chimney, recalling when most of the small dwellings between Mensha and Palmer had been abandoned because of the drought caused by the evil spells. Then she turned her attention to the problem Jex had set her before she had left Falkor. What should she do about Nezaria? Could she do anything about the Leetfjord's buildup of armsmen and lancers in his grandson's realm? Or did she need to wait until Constant acted? Probably, or the lords of the 33 will get even more upset. That didn't include the 1,000 golds she still owed the Ranoid exchange, golds her predecessor had borrowed to pay for the armsmen to fight off the Ebrins. Or the golds she needed to build her own national army, so that Defalk wouldn't always be at the mercy of its adventurous neighbors and of the fractious nobles of its own 33. She took a deep breath. As the first houses of Palmer appeared, Anna forced herself into a more erect and regal position in the saddle. A gray-haired woman looked up from the basket she carried, saw the horses and the regent's banner, then bowed her head to Anna. A door opened on the porch of the next house, but no one stepped out. The old woman quickly lifted her basket of laundry and struggled into a scurry toward the back of the nearer house. The dusty main street of Palmer remained empty, all the way to the center of the town. There, as Anna guided Farinelli to the right onto the street that would become the north road to Lady Gutrun's holding, her eyes went to the chandlery on the street, leading westward out of the center of town. She found herself shaking her head ever so slightly, recalling how Forse, the chandler, had tried to rape her. And she'd scarcely been that provocative, not in trousers and shirt and vest and covered with road dust. All she'd wanted had been directions, and she'd ended up turning him to ashes when he'd barred the door and turned a bow on her after she'd refused his advances. Anna looked back over her shoulder, realizing that the entire town had been quiet, that outside of a dog and the older woman carrying laundry, she had seen no one. The rain? She frowned, then straightened in the saddle and looked ahead along the road. It would be good to see Lady Gutrun's friendly face. The day was darkening into twilight, and sprinkles of rain had begun to fall a good half-glass before Anna's force and her players rode slowly through the stone gates, a deck or so north of Palmer. The duty guards rang a bronze bell by the gates, an innovation since Anna's last visit, and Captain Fierce was waiting by the stables. Even in the dim light of late twilight, Anna could tell that Fierce's salt-and-pepper beard was even whiter than it had been a year before, although his face remained almost as young-looking as ever,
despite the few additional lines around his eyes.
"Regent and Lady,"
Ferris bowed as Anna reined up.
"More beautiful than ever."
"Captain Ferris, bold as ever." She couldn't help grinning at the man's effrontery. "It's good to see you."
"I but follow your example as regent and leader."
Anna shook her head and dismounted, trying not to stagger as her legs took up her weight, and holding the raised cantle of the saddle for a moment before stepping a pace or so away from Farinelli.
"You will groom him before you go to meet Lady Gatrun."
"It won't take long." Anna nodded. Farinelli suffered only Tursic in Falkor, Quies in Mencia, and a handful of other grooms in all Defalk to approach him except to feed him. One of the drawbacks of a raider beast. "Is there some sort of shelter for my players and armsmen?" She beckoned. "Liende?" The chief player eased her mount forward, stopping beside Hymar. "Hymar is my overcaptain," Anna explained, "and Liende my chief player. You may recall Liende, she was with us at the Sand Pass battle."
"The players, Lady Gatrun said that they would be quartered in the main house, as would your officers. Lady Gatrun asked me to join you and the senior members of your party for dinner, once you all have refreshed yourselves."
Ferris paused.
"You have 50?
"Armsmen, yes."
"It will be crowded, but between the hall in the west barracks and the few empty caserns in the older barracks, we can shelter all of them. I would be pleased to show over Captain Hymar."
Ferris nodded again.
"The front large stall has been swept and cleaned for you."
"Thank you. If you would show Hymar," Anna said tiredly, beginning to lead Farinelli out of the light rain and toward the stable.
"I would be pleased. This way," said Ferris to Hymar.
While Lejeune unsaddled and groomed both guards' mounts, Rickle stood watch as Anna began to groom Farinelli. Before Anna knew it, Ferris had returned. He peered over the stall wall.
"It amazes me to see a regent grooming her mount."
"Why? He saved my life more times than I can count." The discomfort of the remark, almost like a faint sense of Darksong, prompted Anna to add, "A good handful of times, at least." After setting aside the brush, she left the stall, carrying the lutar that had been strapped behind her saddle. Lejeune carried the saddlebags with her few changes of clothes and limited toiletries. "How are you doing in training the ladies' forces?" Anna asked her captain, as she stepped out of the stable into the light rain. Ferris smiled.
"The training here goes well."
His smile faded. "There's a problem." Anna glanced around. "Perhaps you should come and see me later." Ferris frowned, then smiled wryly.
"Almost, Lady Regent, I would have deferred. Yet I recall our first meeting. After you are refreshed and we dine, I will attend you at Lady Gatrun's will."
"That might be best." Anna was glad Ferris had suggested consulting Gatrun. "You've got to get out of the habit of saying what comes to mind when you're tired and hungry. People listen to every word." With a faint smile, Anna nodded, recalling her first meeting with Ferris. She'd been tired and not thinking clearly, and Ferris had suggested sorceresses were worse than useless. She'd almost turned Ferris into a bonfire, targeting his goblet instead of him, before apologizing. Then, after the near-disastrous Sand Pass battle, he'd gathered Lord Kaisar's armsmen after the Lord's death and returned the forces to Palmer, where he'd become the chief armsman for Lady Gatrun. Anna lifted the leather-cased lutar, and the two began to walk across the nearly flat ground toward the dwelling. Rickle and Lejeune followed them through the misting rain. The tall and big-boned Gatrun was waiting on the wide stone steps for Anna. In the light of the lamps beside the double doors, her smile was wide and genuine.
"All of Palmer welcomes you, Lady, sorceress and regent."
Lady Gatrun bowed deeply. Beside her, her son bowed, if a trifle after his mother. Anna struggled to remember the boy's name.
as do Kairun and I.
The Lady of Palmer added smoothly, as if she had sensed Anna's inability to remember the heir's name.
I am most glad to be here, Lady Gatrun, in the hold that was the first to welcome and support me, and for that I will always be truly and deeply grateful.
Political as her words had been, Anna still meant them, both to you and Kairun.
What brings you so far east? Will you stay long?
Gatrun stepped back and gestured toward the entry hall beyond the doors. Anna laughed. We are returning from Sorprat. I finally managed to find time to repair the ford there, the one I destroyed more than a year ago.
Just a year ago? Seems like it's been two or three.
Let me offer you the guest chamber and a bath before we eat.
That would be wonderful.
Anna didn't have to feign gratitude for the offer as she followed Gatrun down the side corridor. Kairun and Firis remained in the entry hall, as did Lejeun, but Rickle followed his regent, eyes flicking from side to side along the dim-lit corridor. The Lady of Palmer stopped, perhaps 15 yards down the passage, and opened the heavy, dark oak door. Beyond the door was a bedchamber, a room large enough to hold not only the oversized bedstead, but a love seat before the yellow brick hearth, and a small writing desk with a chair. Two wall candles lit the room. The older-looking blonde led the way to the second door, one that led to a combined dressing room and bath chamber. The copper-enameled tub was already filled, and the doors of the wardrobe against the inside wall lay open.
I know you travel light, like an armsman. There are several gowns in the wardrobe, should you find one you like.
Thank you. Still holding the lutar, Anna smiled. I won't be long.
We await you, lady, and look forward to what you may say.
Gatrun bowed and eased out of the chambers. Once the doors closed and Rickle stationed outside them, Anna uncased the lutar and tuned it, then accompanied herself on the water-heating spell.
Hot and steaming, clean and clear, now make this water to appear.
Setting aside the lutar, she peeled off her dusty riding clothes and slipped into the copper-enameled tub, where she luxuriated in the hot water for a time, before rousing herself and dressing in a green dress from the wardrobe, possibly the same one she had worn the year before. She also borrowed a pair of sandals. Then she opened the chamber door and walked back down the corridor, hoping she hadn't delayed dinner unduly for the others. Both Hymar and Gatrun bowed as Anna approached. A moment later, so did Liende. As if the big-boned but rangy Lady of Palmer had been waiting but a few moments for Anna, Gatrun gestured toward the open double doors of the dining hall. Anna did not argue, but took the seat at one end of the table. Gatrun took the other end, and Firis and Hymar sat on the side to Anna's right, Liende to her left. Two sets of twin-branched candelabra provided the light. Gatrun glanced at Anna. Anna recalled a grace greeting from somewhere and spoke slowly. In the name and spirit of harmony, may we be blessed and may this food pass our lips.
That was nice. I've never heard it quite that way, said Gatrun,
as a serving girl offered the large platter to Anna. Perhaps you didn't recall it quite so well as you thought.
Thank you.
Anna speared two large slabs of meat with her knife and eased them onto her plate, knowing she would probably need a third or fourth just to keep her weight up, especially after the effort she'd made at Sorprat. She took an entire potato coated with cheese as well and broke off a large chunk of crusty bread before passing the willow basket to Liende.
This looks wonderful.
Especially after days of travel, added Hymar.
A third serving girl filled the heavy crystal goblet before Anna with an amber wine. Anna took a small sip.
This is good too. You did not say why you chose to repair the ford now.
I would not pry. Gatrun let her words trail off.
That's simple enough, Anna replied dryly.
I've worried about it ever since I destroyed it, when we defeated the Evolt's forces.
This was the first opportunity I've had to do anything about it. Even so, we'll have to hurry back to Falkor.
Did you build a bridge, as we heard you did across the fall?
Asked Fierce. No, I replaced the ford with one made of stone, but wider and shallower than before. It should be solid enough for wagons, especially when it floods. Fierce nodded.
That will speed travel to the east, observed Gatrun.
Indeed, mumbled Fierce, swallowing quickly.
It may last longer than Defalk, suggested Liende. When the regent creates a sorcery, it is powerful indeed.
Not always, replied Anna. There was this dam.
The flood was powerful, was it not?
Countered the chief player.
And the dam remains, a third cataract on the Falsh.
This was the dam that tilted and started the flood that swept away most of Dumaria and Nauriel,
asked Fierce. Anna nodded as she took another mouthful of the beef, dry beneath the brown gravy. The dam she'd created across the Falsh near Abenfell had drained her energies for weeks, and it had almost been a relief when it had slipped loose from the canyon walls and tilted forward, except for the wall of water that had swept through Dumar, killing thousands and precipitating the Spellsong War with Lord Ahara.
They say that it created a new lake, leagues long. Is that true?
There's a new lake there, Anna answered. How long it is, I don't know. A good reminder of how trying to do too much with Spellsong can create an even worse mess.
Will Dumar keep the agreement? Asked Gatrun bluntly.
Lady Siobhan serves as regent for her son. Her armsmaster serves me. If she fails to keep the agreement, I could let the dam at Abenfell fail completely. Anna took two more slices of beef, as delicately as she could. But how can you be delicate when you have to stuff yourself to maintain the energy you need for spell singing? Gatrun nodded.
It is good that you do not rely just upon faith.
Necessary, but not good. I've discovered that. Anna paused, then asked, How does the harvest look?
Better than in years, but now we must worry about late rains.
Gatrun shook her head.
In past years, we could count on dry weather for harvesting what little survived the dry and heat. Now the fields are high and full, but we could have too much rain.
Let us hope not. Anna took another sip of the amber wine. Have you heard from your sister lately?
Harine has written often. She is well, but she finds herself less sure than she will admit.
Anna smiled at the wry tone. She asks for advice? The white and blonde-haired Lady of Palmer laughed, openly and without rancor.
Truly, it is amazing how matters change.
I thought she would be a good warder for Sargol's heirs.
You were most gracious to allow them to retain their sire's lands, after his treason, pointed out the Lady of Palmer.
He didn't see it as treason, Anna pointed out.
I am a woman, and from another world.
Women with power are not easily accepted in Defalk.
That is true, but you are the regent for the heir to Defalk, and you were confirmed by the 33. Attacking such a regent is treason.
Gatrun's voice was firm as she added,
You were gracious.
Not quite so gracious, Anna admitted. I have indicated that Dinfan will be the heir. She's the oldest.
Gatrun's laugh was almost raucous. And Harine is her warder, and the armsmaster is beholden to you. Even my own brother found that morsel hard to swallow. Yet he finds his sisters with as much power as he, thanks to you, Regent.
I'm not trying to replace men with women. Anna took a sip of the amber wine, a very small sip. I'm just trying to have the best people do the job. If a woman is better, she shrugged.
Some of the older lords find that thought disturbing.
I know. Some have made it very clear. As the serving girl took Anna's empty plate, the regent wanted to shake her head. Once, if she'd eaten four huge slabs of gravied beef, an enormous potato, and half a loaf of bread,
she would have gained who knew how many pounds. Now she worried that she might not have eaten enough for the sorcery she had performed and might be called on to perform daily.
"We have but white cheese and melon," Gatrun apologized.
"That's fine," Anna said. "We didn't give you much warning, and you've been very gracious."
The serving girls set melon, a half melon, before each guest at the table, accompanied by a thick wedge of the white cheese.
"Most gracious," affirmed Liende. "How do you find your quarters?" asked Gatrun. "Comfortable and dry," answered the chief player. "All the players appreciate that, and the food. You and the regent deserve far more than that, but we provide what we can."
The Lady of Palmer smiled.
"We are grateful," replied Liende.
"So am I," Anna said.
When all had finished the cheese and melon, Fierus inclined his head toward Anna, then toward Gatrun.
"If we might be excused, ladies, there are a few matters we must consider for the regent's armsmen."
"And I also," added Liende, "I should see to my players."
Anna accepted the excuse and smiled.
"Of course, I had not realized we had kept you."
"Would that we were kept so more often," answered Fierus.
Liende offered the slightest of wry headshakes, and even stolid Hymar cracked a smile at the younger overcaptain's brazen gallantry. Once the doors closed behind the officers, Anna inclined her head toward the older-looking woman.
"Let us repair to my study," suggested Gatrun, rising.
The study was similar to many Anna had come to visit in Defalk, wood-paneled, with a wall of shelves only partly filled with books, and with a working table-like desk, several chairs, and two side tables between the three chairs facing the desk. The two candles in the wall sconces barely flickered, but also provided but dim illumination. The Lady of Palmer took one of the armed wooden chairs before the desk. This time, Lejeune stood outside the doors, presumably to let Rickle get something to eat. Anna took the one farthest from Gatrun's, leaving a chair vacant between them.
"Fierus has indicated you wished to speak with him."
Gatrun's eyebrows lifted ever so slightly. "Fierus has learned a lot." Anna smiled. "I'm neither here to recruit your captain, nor to use him as a spy. But I need to know what people think, how his men feel. Would you like to sit in?"
"I think Fierus will speak more freely without me, and you will find our views are similar."
"Then tell me," Anna suggested, "what he will say."
"He will try to be tactful, and he will be charming."
Gatrun laughed, but the sound died almost hollowly.
"He worries, and so do I. In the past 2 seasons, many of the tradespeople in Palmer have become less friendly. Yet none has said a hostile word. Not that they would. Several of the serving girls and cook's helpers have begged to move on to my lands, yet none could explain why."
Anna frowned, feeling a coldness grip her stomach, recalling the deserted feeling of Palmer when she had ridden through the town.
"I cannot tell you how candid he may be, but—"
Gatrun frowned.
"The armsmen that he holds and trains have become most skilled, and their consorts and children have asked to live here upon the lands, even unto offering to pay rents, rather than remain among the townsfolk."
"That hasn't happened before. People begging to move on to a lord's lands?"
"Not that I recall."
Gatrun stood.
"Best you talk to Fierus. I will tell him that you await him."
"Thank you." Anna rose as well.
"Thank you, my lady. You concern yourself about my problems, and that is more than any lord of Defalk in memory did."
Anna did not wait long in the dimness of the private study. Fierus bowed as he entered.
"As you requested, regent, these days I no longer question the worth of sorceresses."
His face remained somber, but a hint of amusement lay behind the words. Anna stood beside the broad table, then gestured toward the carved, straight-backed chair before taking a seat behind the table. "I don't question the value of captains and armsmen either," she replied after sitting. "I wish we had more good ones." Fira sat on the edge of the chair.
"I am most pleased to be in the service."
"I'm not recruiting you, Fira. From what I've seen and heard, and from what Lady Gatrun has said, you've done a good job here." Anna paused. "Something here is bothering you, and as regent, I need to know that sort of thing." She waited.
"It is most difficult."
After a moment, the overcaptain added,
"The town of Palmer. It was not this way when I became Lady Gatrun's captain. At first, I thought the strangeness I felt was because I was an outsider. But many of the armsmen have lived all their lives in the domain of Palmer, and most of those have even moved their families to the lands."
Fierus snorted.
"Most times, armsmen will keep their women and consorts as far as they can from a lord's holding."
"It sounds strange," Anna said. "Do you know why?"
"Would that I did, lady. Would that I did. Many feel as I do, yet none has heard or seen anything that would give voice to the cause of those feelings."
"Well, I would appreciate it if you or Lady Gatrun would let me know if anything happens." Anna held in a yawn. The day had been all too long.
"By your leave, regent."
Anna stood. "By my leave, Fierus." After Fierus left, Gatrun appeared in the open study doorway. "You were right," Anna admitted, stifling a yawn. "He was gallant and tactful. And he's worried." "So are you. But what exactly can you do?"
"We will watch and inform you of what we discover."
Anna couldn't stop the next yawn. Lord, she was tired.
"You are tired. We can talk more in the morning."
Gatrun waited for Anna. Lejeun followed the two down the corridor to the guest chambers. When Anna finally stretched out on the big bed, lumpy as most were in Defalk, tired as she felt, her mind continued to race. Both Fierus and Lady Gatrun felt something was wrong in Palmer.
"Is it because of what you did to the Chandler?"
Anna sighed.
"Why do you have to pay for everything you do? Pay more for it than others do."
Still, she wasn't sure that was the cause. She only felt that.
"How often are your feelings wrong?"
There was no answer to that. Not one she liked. 4. Isaria Nazaria. Rabin glances at his own image in the heavy gilt-framed mirror that dominates the dressing room off his bedchamber. Light green eyes survey his high-cheeked, narrow-faced visage. He nods and brushes damp and freshly washed hair back over his left ear. After fingering his beardless chin, he frowns, then readjusts the green cloak of the Prophet of Music. His eyes drop to the miniature portrait on the long dressing table, and he smiles at the dark-haired woman centered in the gold frame.
"I am being patient, as you taught me. But Nubara, all of them, they will find out who is prophet."
As he leaves the dressing room, his eyes go to the bedchamber, where the blonde girl shivers under the silks, pretending to be asleep. And his lips curl into a smile of pleasure momentarily, before he turns and walks down the short hall, stepping through the double doors of his chamber. The Mansouran lancers stiffen. So do the guards who flank the lancers, the pair who wear the cream and green of the Prophet's Guard. Rabin ignores all four and walks, not quite briskly, along the corridor to the stairs, and thence up to the scrying pool. The two guards in green and cream follow, four paces back. From the door, Rabin studies the three players who have risen, and then bowed to him.
"The scrying song, now." "It will take a moment, Prophet, to check the tuning,"
explains the older violino player, bowing again.
Then best you had do so. Quickly.
As the trio of string players tune, Rabin studies them, his eyes going from the graying and heavy-set lead violinist to the balding man, and then to the thin-faced strawberry blonde. He studies the blonde, then looks back to the leader.
We're ready, Prophet.
Play.
Rabin clears his throat and nods, then waits for the melody before starting the spell.
Show me the sorceress of Defalk, what she does, and where she may walk, and who stands by her side and hand.
The scrying pool silvers, revealing a slender blonde woman about to mount a palomino, one of the oversized beasts from the grassland raiders of the north. She swings up into the saddle with an ease born of practice and settles herself quickly, then nods to the officer in Defalcon purple beside her. They ride from the stables toward a column of waiting armsmen. Rabin studies the image, nodding abruptly. He sings the release couplet, and ripples cross the silvered water. The image vanishes, and the pool is but a pool. He turns to the three players, his eyes on the center woman, a heavy figure with graying brown hair.
You did not hold the tone clearly. Best you do better next time.
The violino player swallows.
Yes, Prophet and Seer.
Beside her, the thin and younger strawberry blonde player conceals a silent gulp. Rabin turns and leaves the scrying room. The two prophet's guards again follow as he makes his way down the stairs and along a shaded and columned walkway, toward the open columned hilltop chamber that serves as the summer receiving room. Out beyond the palace of the prophet, the bitter sea is calm and flat under the morning sunlight. Barely a breeze penetrates the columns of the chamber.
Greetings, Lord Rabin.
The overcaptain in the maroon uniform of a Montsoran lancer, who awaits Rabin, stands from behind the small desk to the side and below the dais on which the throne is set.
Good day, Nubara.
The latest prophet of music, Lord of Nezaria and protector of the faith of the eternal melody, fixes his eyes upon his regent.
What have you heard about the sorceress?
She is said to be visiting the eastern lands of Defalk.
Nubara shrugs.
What might she be doing there?
Rabin's voice turns lazy, close to indolent, as he steps onto the dais and settles himself into the throne.
Almost certainly essaying to enlist greater support among the 33, possibly visiting Lady Gatrun. She did not venture so far as her own holdings on the border.
Is it not strange that she has yet to visit her own lands in more than a year?
She cannot obtain support from her own lands, and, as your sire had planned, those lands are among the more distant from Falkor.
Nubara inclined his head, waiting.
I would see Eidlon later in the day. We should hear of his progress in assembling and training the prophet's lancers.
You should indeed,
answers Nubara smoothly.
I should, for once they are ready for battle, then Overcaptain Relor can move his lancers to Eliok. They will be in a position to counter any schemes of the sorceress.
And well away from Isauria as well.
That too,
agrees Rabin, smiling.
Today is the day for petitions. Which is the first?
The rivermen on the Solya River are asking for a copper more for each passenger from Nassalia to Isauria.
Boring, Rabin nods, but necessary. And after that?
A civil dispute between two cloth factors.
5.
The day will be hot,
ventured Hymar from where he rode to Anna's right. Too hot, she agreed, glancing toward the houses ahead, where the town of Palmer began. Under a clear sky, the morning air was still and moist, yet the lingering dampness of the road was the only sign of the previous night's rain. To her left, Rickel nodded, but his eyes, like those of Lejeune, studied the road and the fields that flanked it. and the houses they neared.
Zetchus won't be that long a ride. Late mid-afternoon, 8th or 9th glass, suggested the overcaptain.
Tomorrow is the long ride, she replied, readjusting the floppy brown hat. But the sooner we get back to Falkor, the happier everyone will be. Anna frowned, as a motion from the house they approached caught her eye. Had someone closed a shutter? A door? She turned her head, but the first house remained silent. At the back of the third house Anna passed, a gray-haired woman stood bent over a washtub, shielded from the already strong sun by a sagging porch. As the sound of horses reached her, she straightened. Then she stiffened, but made no other move as the column passed her and continued toward the center of Palmer. Anna's eyes narrowed, and she concentrated on studying each dwelling or shop they neared, wondering if she should uncase the lutar.
In your own land? In a town held by your strongest supporter?
A bearded man peered out of the open window of what looked to be a cabinetry shop, then jerked his head inside as he caught sight of Anna. Fierce was right, she decided. More than right, but there was little she could do about mere chilliness toward the Regency, especially when she could only speculate about the cause.
The Chandler?
Her killing of the man who had tried to assault and kill her hadn't raised any coldness the year before. Anna took a deep breath. She needed to know more, but she still didn't know enough to use her scrying glass to find it out. The problem with asking questions was always that you needed to know a good part of the answer before you could frame a decent question. At the junction of the road from the north with the unnamed main street of Palmer, Anna turned Farinelli right, toward the bridge over the Chian River that lay more than a deck beyond the west end of town. On the left side of the street was the inn, the Green Bull, and the well-endowed animal on the sign was portrayed graphically in green. On the right side, Anna stiffened slightly as she saw the repainted blue and white of the chandlery, the one where she'd been forced to incinerate Forsay. In the doorway stood a figure in brown. As the dark-haired youth or young man, somehow familiar, met her glance, Anna wanted to shiver at the coldness in his eyes. She held her eyes firmly on him until he lowered his gaze. Only then did she blink, for the building almost appeared to have two images, as though she'd used Darksong magic. One image appeared deep brown and brooding black, shadowed, the other a bright white and deep blue and weathered. She blinked again and studied the chandlery. There were still two images. Rickle, do you see the chandlery there? Do you notice anything strange about it? The blonde-haired guard frowned as he looked to the right.
The wood has been painted recently, and the door looks to be new.
Anna wanted to sigh, but only answered, Thank you, the door has been painted in the past year. They had a fire there.
That young fellow, he's watching you, added Hymar.
I imagine he is. I had to kill the Chandler last year. He might be his son. And he probably hates you. Before I became regent, he tried to kill me, when he couldn't rape me.
Not a wise idea, observed Hymar.
I didn't have much choice. At least, you didn't think you did then. Anna glanced at the houses on the left side of the street, but no one appeared outside, unlike the year before when a girl had brought her a basket of gifts in thanks. She thought she could see figures, women, watching from the windows, but no one appeared outside.
Quiet town, suggested Hymar.
Too still by far. The murmur from Liende was barely audible, and Anna agreed with the chief player's words. The unnatural quiet remained for the last deck out of the town. It almost seemed to Anna that not even the birds sang until she had almost reached the stone bridge that spanned the Chian River. Two things bothered her about Palmer. Of those who had watched her, none had come out to see the regent, and most were women. The handful of men had looked away, not spit,
or expressed open dislike, but just looked away. Then there had been the feel of the chandlery, something like Darksong, and the man who had watched. She knew the face was familiar and that she should have recognized him, but she hadn't, except for knowing that he had to be some relative of the late Forsay. Does that lack of recognition come from having to meet and remember too many people in too short a time? Should you have stopped and investigated? Anna knew she couldn't stop and deal with everything that felt wrong. But there was that nagging sense that she should have recognized something about the son of Forsay, that she knew him from somewhere. Clearly, there was something about Palmer, despite Lady Gutrune's hospitality, that felt wrong. Then, what doesn't these days? 6. Palmer Defalk. The two young and bearded men watch as the column passes along the main street westward, back toward Falkor, one in the doorway of the chandlery, one from the window beside the door, half hidden by the shutters. Once the last armsman rides past the chandlery, and then past the coppersmith's porch, the older of the two men steps back into the store.
The bitch sorceress, our beloved regent, with such a pretty face, so innocent looking, as if she had no evil on her soul. He snorts as he looks at his brother. So evil. She is evil, and none see it. But they will. They will. Oh, they will.
Then why did you do nothing, Farson? Asks the younger. You have spoken against the sorceress. There she was. But a handful of armsmen rode between you and her, and you did nothing. I had most of my drums ready.
Now is not the time, my brother.
Farson smiles.
She has not suffered enough, and she will suffer.
You mean that you are not yet skilled enough to stand against her?
Gearson raises his eyebrows.
What then? She will be back in Falkor, Farson. Her power grows daily. Even the Leitfjord of Mansur has acknowledged her regency.
Gearson rubs his forehead, then uses the maple mallet to tap the single drum that rests on the wooden floor beside him. He cocks his head and listens to the sound.
Do you not see? Do you not care? I saw the blazing pyre she made of our father, a man, a worthy man, our father, and she turned him to ashes. A woman, a lowly bitch from beyond dissonance, and she destroyed him on a whim,
snaps the chandler in brown. His voice rises almost into a screech.
We suffered from the fire that burned half the merchandise. Did she offer a coin? A condolence? Did she even look back?
I wasn't there, points out the drummer.
You didn't have to be. I was, and I saw. And she will suffer.
Gearson shrugs.
As you say. I do say. I will say.
Farson glares at his younger brother.
And she will suffer.
The drummer nods, then looks at the wooden floor. The silence between them lengthens.
How are the other drums coming? Asks Farson,
long after the sound of hoofs has died away.
They are almost ready, but even with 8, I can only play simple melodies.
Gearson runs his fingertips over the wood of the drums.
Simple will be enough.
The young chandler in brown smiles, and his eyes fix on an image none can see but him.
More than enough. Far more than she will expect.
7. Still dusty from the ride, Anna sank into the upholstered wooden armchair beside her bedchamber's small working desk table. The room was dim, lit by but the single taper on the desk and one candle in the wall sconce inside the heavy oak door. Her stomach growled,
and she wondered which she wanted more, food or a hot bath. Her eyes flicked to the wall and the black rectangle etched there. A different, deeper pain burned through her.
How long? How long before you can try to see Elisabetta again? Tomorrow? It's been almost a season, and Brill said you could look across the mist worlds occasionally.
The last time she'd tried to use her sorcery to see her youngest child, the mirror had exploded. Anna had been most fortunate that the knife-sharp glass fragments had not killed her.
But you have a pool now. Water doesn't explode the way glass mirrors do.
Her eyes flicked to the door as she heard the rap on the wood in Lejeune's announcement.
Lord Jex is here, Lady Anna.
Have him come in. Anna straightened in the chair.
Tomorrow, when you're more rested, then you can see about Elisabetta.
The white-haired and clean-shaven Lord of Elheld smiled as he stepped into her chamber.
You returned sooner than I thought, my Lady Regent.
A certain lord suggested that if I had to repair a ford, I had better do it quickly and get back to the important business of being regent. She gestured to the other straight chair, the one beside the writing desk.
I do not recall being so incautious as to say anything such as that.
Jex raised his eyebrows as he settled gracefully, if slightly gingerly, into the chair. The pallor had left his face, although his outdoor tan had faded, and a trace of gauntness had left his face 5 years older than it had been. The smile he bestowed on Anna was as devastating as always, but she managed to avoid swallowing or overtly betraying the attraction she felt.
My dear Lord Jex, you didn't need to voice a word.
Anna rose. I'm dusty and tired and hungry. I'm going to take a bath. Would you like to join me for dinner in a while? I won't be long.
I would be most pleased. Then I can tell you what has transpired in your absence.
Not much, I hope.
You may have been correct in feeling that the time was right to repair the ford at Sorprat.
His lips quirked into another smile. Things are getting worse someplace, I can tell that. She gestured toward the door. Let me get cleaned up. I'll see you in the small dining hall. She paused.
You wouldn't mind sending a message to the kitchen, would you? I don't think I did.
She offered a rueful smile. It's been a long day.
I would be most happy to ensure we are fed, my lady.
Jex rose and bowed. Once the heavy door closed, Anna slid the bolt and walked to the bath chamber adjoining her bed and work chamber. The water, lukewarm, was already in the tub. Slowly, she tuned the lutar, then sang.
Water, water in the bath below, both hot and soothing flow.
Once she had the water not quite steaming and a headache from doing the spell on an empty stomach, she replaced the lutar in its case and plopped into the high-sided tub, spilling water onto the stone floor of her bath chamber.
Damn,
slipped from her lips. Anna pushed away the irritation at her clumsiness and concentrated on washing her face with a square of rough cloth. When she'd been a student in Europe, washcloths had been hard to find, and they weren't exactly common in Defalk. Necessary though she found them for removing road dust and other grime, especially since deodorants weren't in the primitive chemical repertoire of Erde, and perfume was hard to come by, even for a regent. Then everything was hard to come by in impoverished and beleaguered Defalk, although it was getting slightly less difficult, thanks to the golds she'd added to the treasury through subduing a few unruly lords, and Dumar. The battles in Dumar might well have been easier than the problems she still faced. Jex's very presence upon her arrival indicated his concern for her, and his concern for Defalk and the regency for his grandson Jim Bob. What was the problem? Something wrong in Dumar? Or with the lords of the 33? Or Nezaria? Or... The list of possibilities was all too depressingly long. Probably some Defalcan lord.
She washed and dressed quickly, choosing a plain green gown, since all but one of her limited workday clothes, trousers, shirts, and vests, were filthy. "Amazing that you're the ruler of a land, and your wardrobe is less than when you were an assistant professor of music." Jex was waiting outside the door, talking to Gielum and Kerhor, the two duty guards.
"And it's still spouting flaming rock."
The white-haired lord broke off his words as he saw Anna.
"Lady."
"Yes, I look almost human without the road dust all over me, Lord Jex." She inclined her head to the guards in turn. "It's good to see you both. Did you get some rest while I was gone?"
Some, Lady Anna," admitted the black-haired Kerhor. "Except Lord Jex and Arms Commander Hanfor had us drilling every day." "Many glasses," added Gielum, his voice mock mournful.
"They needed the practice," Jex said, "and they don't have the time when you're around."
"I hope you worked hard and learned something," Anna temporized.
"Both Lord Jex and Arms Commander Hanfor strike hard."
Anna winced. She doubted Jex had any business teaching arms yet. "You were out there with a blade?" she asked him, as they turned the corner and headed down the stone stairs to the lower floor and the small dining hall. "You're not..."
"I am mostly healed, my lady, thanks to your sorcery, and I will not sit around the Leetburg and be thought a useless old daughterer."
"Even when you were barely moving, you were worth more than a dozen men who can't do anything but swing those blades."
"That is not the way the young ones see it,"
Jex laughed sardonically. The way Defalk was, Anna suspected he was all too right. "Do I work them too hard? Should we recruit some more?"
"That might be wise, especially if you insist on traveling all over Leetwar."
The small dining hall was set for two, with two three-branched candelabra providing the light. Jex waited for Anna to sit. Courtesy in Defalk did not extend to seating women, merely allowing the highest or most noble to sit first. A serving girl Anna did not recognize hurried in with a basket of fresh-baked bread, followed by a figure she did. "Delilah!" The once stocky and now petite brunette smiled as she set the crockery casserole dish on the pottery tile serving as a trivet, then bowed. "Regent, I didn't expect you..." Anna had worked out the arrangements for Daffod's sister to teach the younger children in the Leetburg and to help Marin in the kitchen. But that had been before she had left Falkor to deal with the uprising in southern Defalk and the attack from Lord Ahara of Dumar. "Lord, you lose track of things." Sometimes, Anna felt she couldn't keep track of half of what was going on. "Marin was feeling ill, but Asalan is watching Ruetha and Anadra." "How are you getting along with Marin?"
"Very well," answered Jex. "We're getting some new dishes, I've noticed."
He inclined his head toward the casserole.
"Is that one of them?"
"Yes, sir. This is the stew you liked, Regent."
Anna could feel her mouth water. "That's wonderful." She smiled at Jex. "You'll like it."
"I've liked all the new dishes. It was one of the few pleasures left for a time."
Anna looked at Delilah. "Are you sure you're doing all right?"
"Oh, yes. Dithya has me teaching letters to some of the smaller children in the Leetburg."
The pert brunette offered Anna another smile, then turned and slipped from the dining hall.
"That one. She's another that would lay her life in front of a charger for you."
Anna didn't argue, only nodded. "You took refuge in her home, and after you rejected the forceful advances of her consort, he left her penniless and friendless, and his brother took everything because Delilah was a woman unable to hold property. You made her brother your chief player, and he died fighting the Evolt. And now, because you pay her for cooking and teaching, she thinks you're wonderful." Defalk needed more feminism than one sorceress and regent could ever supply. Anna poured herself some of the maroon wine, then filled Jex's goblet.
Thank you, lady. It is unusual to be served by a ruler.
Just remember that. Anna broke off a chunk of bread, then served two huge ladlefuls of the stew. What was so urgent that you were waiting for me?
I would not say it was terribly urgent, and it should wait until you have eaten. You are most pale,
Jex said. It has been a while since I ate. Midday, I think.
What if you had to sing a spell?
I'd have been in trouble. Anna took a mouthful of the stew, the spices muting the taste of the strong mutton. The second mouthful she accompanied with a chunk of the dark bread. Dark bread. They had it. And that meant someone was indeed getting molasses from Dumar, or had recently. Did that mean that Lady Siobhan was keeping the agreement, and that all was well with Alvar, the Captain Anna had made overcaptain and armsmaster of Dumar, both to aid Siobhan's regency, and to ensure Dumar's compliance with the terms of surrender, even if Anna had been careful not to call them precisely that?
You carry provisions,
he said gently, not quite suggesting that she was a fool not to have eaten them.
What happens to those who travel with you if you cannot protect them?
I know. I should have eaten more. She continued to eat the stew and bread, also slicing a peach and thin wedges of white cheese. When she had cleared her plate, twice, she looked up. Now, what's the problem?
It is not a difficulty, yet. Not all of them.
Jex held the wine goblet, but did not take a swallow. All of them? Anna's stomach tightened. Start with the worst.
None is pressing, yet. Go on. All of the Monsoran Lancers in Nezeria will soon be to Eliok. Those are the reports.
How many is that? You need to get busy with your scrying pool.
50 score, and either young Rabin or Nubara has formed a new force, the Prophet's Lancers. According to Arms Commander Hanfor, the new Prophet can muster at least another 200 score Lancers and Armsmen.
A trained Nezerian army of more than 5,000 men, and she had perhaps 300 pledged to her, plus the levies of the Defalcan lords, if they heeded the call. Still, she'd destroyed more than that in the war with Dumar. And look what it did to you and Jex. There's more. Jex shrugged, almost apologetically.
The South women have sent arms to Alawa, and Lord Bertman is assembling men and boats on the River Dol, as if he will be using the river to ferry men there.
The Ranowans wouldn't sell us arms, but they'll send them to Alawa?
To the free women there. They revolted.
That's a good way to get slaughtered, especially in this world. And you're supposed to support Hadron to pull them out? How did we find that out?
Minares received a message from Wei.
The last message from Wei led to the problems with Dumar, Anna said slowly.
I thought you might see it that way.
We can't afford to do much for Hadron.
If you do not.
Jex let the silence drag out. I know, then we'll be back to having unfriendly neighbors on both the east and the west borders, with the inscrutable traitors of Wei breathing down on us from the north. I suppose the Ranowans will be unhappy if we don't support these free women?
That I could not say.
What else? Anna asked, knowing there had to be more bad news.
The rider of Hainin has asked for aid. The wet spring caused the grass to grow far higher than in past years, and there was a fire that swept half the grasslands.
So they have no forage? Jex nodded. You bring such cheerful news, my lord. I take it you've got more of the same?
You recall Lord Vlasa.
He was the Lord of Fussen, the one whose twin sons were fighting over the lands.
Ustal and Falar have both raised armsmen, and each has sent a scroll requesting that you recognize him. You did say I should read scrolls.
I did. Go on.
Falar is the younger by a fraction of a glass, and he wrote that, should you not support him and should he prevail, he will consider seeking support for his just claim elsewhere.
Let me guess, Anna hazarded. Ustal has the traditional right to the lands, and he's some sort of idiot or wastrel or something.
Ah, why do you suggest such?
Jex raised his eyebrows. Because, for a younger son to go to such lengths would mean he's either an idiot, or he has a just claim. If he can raise armsmen, that means people are putting themselves on the line for him, against tradition. Most folks won't. That suggests that Ustal has more than a few faults, of some sort. Anna took a bigger sip of wine than she'd intended before asking, Can Minores or Dithya or someone find out what Ustal's faults are? In the meantime, you send back a scroll to each, saying that I'm returning from Palmer and will look at the claims as soon as I return. Jex smiled.
You will gain 2 weeks by that.
If that.
Oh, and the weaponsmith, the one who was a wheelwright, he was killed in a tavern brawl.
And we are back to having no one in Falkor who can forge weapons. Anna refilled her goblet, knowing she shouldn't be drinking so much so quickly, but she'd taken a little over a week to repair something that needed to be fixed, and the moment she'd left, things had started to get worse. She paused. Was the brawl an accident? Jex shrugged.
I would say so, but one could not rule out foul play.
No, not when we need an armorer to hold off enemies on half our borders. Anna forced herself to take a small sip of the wine.
Hanfor has suggested you create the position of Armorer of Defalk and offer a 10 gold bonus for an experienced smith.
20, said Anna. 10 to be paid after the first 2 weeks, and 10 after the first year. Send scrolls everywhere.
Tomorrow, I will talk to Hanfor.
Well, since we're discussing problems, there's one more. Jex waited. There was this youth at the Chandlery. Anna swallowed. The one in the pools in your seeking spells, the one who wants your destruction. Shit! Jex's mouth dropped open. It's hard to explain. Come with me. She pushed back her chair and started for the door, and Jex rose, following. Lejeune and Kerhor followed them back up the stairs, first to Anna's chamber, where she grabbed the lutar, and then to the scrying room, the room that had once been a guest chamber and now held only a mirror pool and a writing desk, and candles in wall sconces. The two guards stationed themselves outside the door, while Jex lit the candles and Anna tuned the lutar.
You think you will see something now?
Jex gestured toward the darkness beyond the closed shutter. Enough, grunted Anna, struggling with the tuning pegs. A single vocalize was enough to clear her chords, enough for the simple spell she sang, at least. Of those with power of the song, seek those who do me wrong, and show them in this silver cast, and make that vision well last. As it had been the last time she had used the spell, there were 3 images, but one was different. The blonde seer from Nordway was in one silvered circle. The second contained a dark-haired and thin-faced youth in an ornate cream and green tunic, lounging at a table beside a less than fully clothed young woman. His face was familiar, though Anna had never seen it, and so were the cream and green.
Nazarian colors there, murmured Jex.
That has to be Rabin, concluded Anna. He looks more like his mother.
He's acting like his sire.
Jex's voice was dry. It's the other one, the one in brown. Anna gestured toward the young man at the battered-looking writing table. He was watching me in Palmer, and I knew I'd seen him. I just couldn't place where I'd seen his face.
A Chandler's son.
He's the Chandler's son. He has to be. You remember, the one who tried to kill me with a bow in Palmer when I was on my way to meet Balaam.
That was before you became regent,
Jex pointed out. He uses Darksong. The whole chandlery felt twisted when I looked at it, but I thought it was me. Anna sang the release couplet. Let this scene of scrying, mirror filled with light, vanish like the darkness when the sun is bright. Jex tilted his head sideways.
He uses Darksong, and he's opposing you, but he's only a chandler.
Until I became a sorceress, I was only a teacher and a singer, she replied. Jex shook his head.
You were always a sorceress and a regent.
Anna frowned. Does that mean what you think it does?
He is only a chandler who would be a dark singer.
I still have to do something about him.
You can't do anything about it tonight,
Jex pointed out reasonably.
Tomorrow, you can send a messenger to Lady Gutrune and have her people find out the man's name and what they know about him.
That made sense, but she knew it wouldn't be enough. Once again, it was looking like what she could do wouldn't solve the problem. Tomorrow, she agreed. And I'll have to look for Bertman and see what he's doing. And those Monsoran Lancers. Tomorrow. Will every tomorrow always be filled with more tasks than you started yesterday with? 8. As the sunlight poured through the Leetberg window, Anna struggled up into a sitting position in the bed. Her eyes were gummy and her head ached. Too much not very good wine last night. Not a good idea either, with more problems today. As she took a slow, deep breath and swung her feet to the side of the bed, the black etched rectangle on the wall, the visual representation of the last time she'd been able to see her daughter through her sorcery, strobed at her. She closed her eyes again and just sat on the edge of the bed. You can kill and create great bridges and rule a country, but you can't use sorcery to see your daughter. After a moment, she found herself correcting that thought. You weren't able to see her for a while, but it's been more than a season since you tried. Brill said it could be done across the gap between the Mist Worlds and Erde infrequently, not never. She padded to the bath chamber, where she washed up and then dressed in her remaining clean green working trousers and shirt. After pulling on the brown leather boots, she trudged to the door and opened it. Blaz and Rickle were the guards. If you would, please, have someone bring me some breakfast.
Yes, Lady Anna,
Rickle answered. Thank you. She closed the door and went to the writing desk, rummaging around until she found a sheet of parchment. What do you say to a daughter a world away? A daughter growing up without you? She dipped the quill carefully and began to write. No, that's not... She scratched through the words, knowing she couldn't afford to crumple the parchment. She'd just have to use one sheet for drafting and then recopy. A second beginning wasn't any better, nor was a third, and she set the parchment aside at the knock on the door.
Delilah, Lady Anna, with your breakfast.
Come on in. Anna stood as the brunette brought in the tray, on which were piled a wedge of yellow cheese and fresh bread, a lopsided peach, and a large pitcher of water.
We didn't cook anything, lady. If you want more...
Delilah waited. This is fine, Anna smiled. How are the children?
Ruetha is doing well. I am letting her learn letters with the older bairns. I hope you do not mind.
That's fine. When she's older, she can learn numbers from Dithya as well.
You would let her...
Of course. Anna wanted to frown. Dithya doesn't come from lordly blood. She got where she is because she's able. I want the same to be true for Ruetha and Anadra and all the young girls in the Leetberg. And throughout Defalk. As much as possible.
I would want that, yet...
Delilah left the question unvoiced. How long will that be possible? asked Anna. "So long as I'm regent, and if I'm a good one, a long time after that."
"You will be regent for many years."
"We'll have to see. Right now, it doesn't look all that promising."
"You will."
Delilah bowed, turned, and slipped out the door. Before eating, Anna did take the precaution of taking out the lutar and order-spelling the water. She found she finished everything, even gnawing the peach down to the pit. As she sipped another goblet of water, the headache faded, then vanished. Dehydration, or low blood sugar, or both. After setting aside the tray, Anna wrote out the letter to Elisabetta, slowly, carefully, then wrapped the 4 golds she took from her wallet in old parchment and placed them in the crude envelope. With a deep breath, she stood. Carrying the lutar and envelope, she walked to the door, opened it, and stepped out. "I'll be working across the hall."
"Yes, Lady Anna."
Rickle nodded, and he and Blaz followed her, resuming a guard position around the scrying room's door. Anna closed the door, stepping forward, and glanced at the silvered waters of the pool. She set the envelope on the work table. After retuning the lutar and running through 2 vocalizes, she lifted the lutar and began to sing. "Bertman, Bertman, Lord I'd see, show his forces now to me." The image in the silvered waters of the pool was that of a quay, where several barges were tied, and where men in brown carried barrels toward the barge in the foreground. At the side were several armsmen, almost lounging. The fact that there were buildings and greenery in the distance beyond the gray of the water confirmed to Anna what Jex had said about Bertman loading on the River Dahl. After a time, she lifted the lutar again. "Rabin, Rabin, Lord who'd be, show his grandsire's lancers now to me." The second image was less useful than the first, showing a column of lancers garbed in maroon and riding along a dusty road. Still, the length of the column indicated the lancers were on the move, possibly toward Eliok, and probably confirming the information that Jex and Menares had gathered. Now what? Anna released the second image and took a deep breath. "First, you do something for you." After a moment, she lifted the lutar a third time. "Silver pool, silver pool, it's scrying time for my child, silver pool, silver pool." Even before she strummed the last chord, the silvered waters wavered into an image. Her red-haired Elisabetta, driving in a green car Anna didn't recognize, a faint smile on her face. Anna smiled in return. "She's all right." Then the water of the pool began to boil, and gouts of steam burst upward. Anna jumped back, forcing the release couplet. Even after the image faded, the pool continued to boil and bubble, the roiling subsiding slowly. "Elisabetta is all right, though. That's what's important." But the tears that rolled down Anna's cheeks contradicted her words as she slumped against the heavy oak door, sobbing silently. "Why? Why? Why can't you even get a look at your daughter for more than an instant without the whole universe striking back at you? Why?" She picked up the envelope with the unsent letter and stepped out of the heat and humidity of the scrying room into the hallway, half carrying, half dragging the lutar with her. The eyes of both Rickle and Blaz widened as the steam and water vapor swirled out behind her.
"Lady, Regent," stammered Blaz.
"I'll be all right." She walked across the hall and slipped quickly into her own chamber, sliding the bolt behind her, then dropping the unused envelope on the writing desk. In the bath chamber, she looked into the mirror. Red face, blotchy as if burned, probably from the steam. Wet cheeks. "You look like shit." "Then you feel like shit, too. You couldn't even send a letter. Not even one small letter." She looked back into the mirror, into the too thin face, at the golden silver blonde hair that belonged to a teenager and framed blue eyes that had seen too much.
She blotted her face with cool water and kept blotting. There were times when having makeup would have still been a help, youth spell or not. Finally, she returned to the writing desk and tucked the envelope into the drawer.
Just try to send it, with another note. Maybe you can tell her to write something and that you'll try to recover it with sorcery in a few weeks. Would that work?
Who knew what would work? Even all of Brill's books offered little and rather incomplete guidance. She gathered herself together, then stepped back into the corridor and headed down to the receiving room and the business of the day. Based on what Jex had already offered the night before, a long week awaited her. Another long year, more likely. She reclaimed the lutar case and carried the cased instrument down the stairs. Once in the receiving room, already warm with its single high window, Anna looked at the pitcher of murky water. After a sigh, she took out the lutar and order-spelled the water. Without water, clean water, she wouldn't get through the day. Then she poured a goblet and took a swallow before settling into the chair behind the table. She lifted the bell and rang it. A dark-haired page, Skent, peered in.
Yes, Lady Anna?
Skent, it's good to see you. Will you see if Counselor Dithya is free to meet with me?
Yes, lady.
The door closed. Anna picked up the first scroll in the pile. It was from Lord Burfells of Abenfell. She began to read.
You may recall when you were in Abenfell, Lady and Regent, that we had discussed the possible consorting of Lysara with Herda, the son of Lord Danil of Mossback.
In short, Anna murmured to herself, we intend to marry off Lysara to Herda immediately unless you come up with a better match, and better means someone with more lands and golds, not brains. She wondered if Danil was as thick-headed as his youngest son. The problem was simple enough, but simple didn't mean solvable. Anna had started a school for fosterlings in the Liedberg, which functioned as a combination capital and administrative center. Many of the lords of the 33 regarded the fosterling school as more of a matchmaking opportunity. Lysara was beautiful and bright, and would be totally miserable consorted to the stubborn, arrogant, and thick-headed Herda. Unfortunately, Anna didn't have the faintest idea of who might be a better match.
You mean you haven't had time to think about it?
What could she say? She set aside Burfell's scroll and picked up the next one, from Viarl, the lord and rider of Hainin. She read quickly, but the scroll said little more than what Jex had told her the night before about the grasslands and the fires. The next scroll was from Hadron, the self-styled Lord of Sinek, whom she'd made one of the 33 earlier in the year, effectively expanding Defalk's borders a good 150 decks eastward and probably increasing the territory under the regency by close to 20%. If he and you can hold it against Burtman. Hadron's words were to the point.
The golds you have sent have allowed me to increase my armsmen by 10 score, but the usurper Burtman receives many more golds from both the Mater of Stirren and the Leitfjord of Mansur. Already Burtman's forces move south to take Alawa from the Council of the Free Women.
That meant that Ibra was split into 3 factions. The Free Women apparently held the port city of Alawa, and at least some of the surrounding area. Burtman held the northeastern third, and Hadron the western third. Who or what the Free Women were was another question to which she needed an answer. Anna nodded and set the scroll in the pile that required her to do something, when she could figure out what. The next scroll was from Ustal, the elder son of the late Lord Vlasa of Fussen. Anna began to read, then winced, and forced herself to continue.
The Regent in Falkor. Greetings from Ustal, the son and sole heir of Lord Vlasa of Fussen. For many years Fussen has paid Leitgeld it could sore afford, and received nothing in return, save drought, disruption, and the loss of levies at the Sand Pass. Thus, as heir to Lord Vlasa, I must insist that the Regency use all its powers to ensure the rightful and traditional succession in Fussen. If the Regency feels it cannot adjudicate and enforce the rightful succession, then I further must insist that Fussin be allowed to determine its own affairs.
Anna shook her head as she finished the scroll. After Ustal's scroll, Jex, or Dithya, had set the one from Falar, the younger son of the late Lord Vlasa of Fussin. Anna began to read it, gingerly.
To the Regent of Defalk, Sorceress of the Land and the Lady of Mensha, your graciousness, with heavy heart and burdened conscience, I send this missive. Because you have sacrificed much for Defalk, and will doubtless sacrifice more in the years to come, your heart may also be heavy with the news of dissension about the succession in Fussin. Unlike others, I have been reluctant to address you. Yet address you I must, not for my sake, but for the sake of the people of Fussin.
Anna smiled. Young Falar, or his advisors, were far from stupid.
My elder brother has abused the trust of the people and squandered the substance of Fussin, so much so that the merchants and freeholders have requested that I seek the succession and pledged their lives and coins to that end.
Anna's lips tightened. If what the scroll said was indeed true, matters were a mess in Fussin. Behind Falar's scroll were Jex's responses, identical to each brother, stating that the regent was returning from repairing the ford at Sorprat and would be addressing the concerns of the succession upon her return. Anna nodded. She never had to tell Jex anything twice.
He's told you things twice, that he shouldn't have had to.
Anna winced at the thought.
Counselor Dithya, announced another page, Resor.
Have her come in.
Anna set down the scrolls for the moment.
Lady Anna.
The gray-haired and stocky Dithya bowed as she entered the receiving room. Anna nodded to the seat across the small conference work table from her.
Where do we stand with our golds?
I thought you might wish to know.
Dithya smiled and extended a single sheet of parchment.
Those show what the Leetstadt has received and what remains in the treasury.
Anna looked at the precise black script numbers. 6,000 golds from Chior, 3,000 from Sul, 2,000 from Stromwer, and 2,000 from Dumar.
Dumar owes another 4,000 golds, Dithya pointed out,
and we owe the Ranowin Exchange 1,000.
Not until harvest.
Have it sent now. We could use the goodwill.
My lady,
Dithya cleared her throat.
About the accounts.
Anna skipped to the bottom line. Barely 1,000 more than what her expeditions of submission and conquest had brought in. You're going to tell me that we're spending more golds and that we're spending them faster than we had planned?
Yes, lady.
How much faster? Anna's voice was wary. She took another swallow of the water. Already the room felt stifling, despite the open window behind her.
Almost 4,000 golds more.
Dithya eased a sheet of parchment across the table. Anna scanned the listing. Nearly 1,000 golds more in supplies for the Leetburg, to replace food stocks and other things that Barjum had not. Anna had authorized that. 400 golds for wrought iron stock for the weaponsmith, whom they had to replace. Nearly 1,000 golds in silvers paid to the armsmen who had followed and supported Anna in her campaign to subdue the rebellious Sulmoran lords of Defalk and Lord Ahara of Dumar. 800 golds for replacement mounts. Anna took a deep breath. She'd authorized most of the expenditures. But after we pay everything, we should still have almost 7,000 more than at the beginning of summer.
6,000, if you pay the Ranowins, and you cannot count on the Leetgeld being paid on time,
Dithya pointed out. Only from Chior, Elheld, and Mensha, Anna replied, adding after a pause, and Stromwer, Sul, Lerona, Abenfell, and Palmer. A surprised look crossed Dithya's face, as if a quarter of the lords paying on time were a novelty.
That is true.
But you're right, Anna replied. We will be cutting it close. I still want to pay the Ranowans, though. If we or any of the lords have to borrow from them in the future, it might make it easier. We also may need allies, and a land that repays its debts is a better ally than one who doesn't. She paused. If you would draft a scroll and make the arrangements with Arms Commander Hanford to ensure the repayment reaches Ancora safely.
Yes, lady.
Also, perhaps you could draft a scroll to go with that party, and copies that could be sent elsewhere. We'll offer a 20 gold bonus for weaponsmith. 5 golds after examination of his work, 5 golds after the first month, and 10 golds after the first year. Dithya nodded. How is the schooling going for the pages and fosterlings?
Well enough, for most.
Dithya's voice was cautious. Except Herda is becoming impossible.
He has difficulty with numbers. He has little interest in them and less in learning them from a woman.
Anna shook her head sadly. How about the others? What about Nelmore's heir, Tirson, is it?
After the first weeks, he is fine. His sister had a word with him, I believe.
A smile crossed Dithya's lips. Anna smiled as well. Had the timid Yutrude actually had the nerve to advise her brother?
Any other problems?
No. The others learn well. Some, like Katarizna and Lysara, know as much as I do already. And even young Sekka has begun to do complicated sums like the others. Skent is the best of the young men, but Jimbob works hard.
That the heir of Defalk worked hard was good, but Anna hoped at least some of the motivation was internal, rather than provided by his grandsire externally.
Lord Jex, lady, announced Resor.
Anna motioned for the white-haired lord to enter.
Will that be all?
Asked Dithya, standing.
Just for now, Anna said.
I wanted to know how things stood before I started thinking about spending golds.
Would that more rulers thought such, my lady,
Jex offered as he bowed to Anna. Dithya bowed and slipped out of the receiving room. With Anna's gesture, Jex took the seat the counselor had vacated. How am I supposed to deal with the mess in Fussin? She asked him.
As regent, you must reach a decision about which will inherit, and quickly.
I don't know either one. Jex smiled.
Yet, my lady.
I think, you schemer, that you are saying I need to go to Fussin and meet the two young men.
How else will you know them? How else will the 33 feel at ease with your decision? You have not been to the west of Defalk, my lady.
If I upheld the older male, no one would say anything, so... She dragged out the word. That means that you think something's rotten in Fussin, or at least with Ustal, and you think my presence will reassure such stalwarts as Nelmore
and Lord Jurl.
Anna looked and felt blank at the last name. She took another swallow of water and blotted a forehead that had become damp as the mid-morning heat had begun to build in the receiving room.
Lord of Denguig, Jex explained.
The name was vaguely familiar, but probably only from the Leetgeld lists. We haven't heard much from him.
He is the Lord of the Western Marches, Jex explained. He was supposed to defend the approach from Nezeria.
He didn't do much to stop Balaam.
Jex nodded.
He sent a scroll claiming that he had lost 10 men and would have lost all had he not surrendered. He relinquished the title and the 1/3 exemption from Leetgeld.
Whom did he send it to? Anna asked. Balaam didn't march into Defalk until after Lord Barjum was killed at the Sand Pass.
It was addressed to Barjum and was waiting at the Leetburg for Lord Balaam. Menares found it and brought it to me some time back.
No wonder he paid his Leetgeld on time, Anna muttered. Barjum and his consort Alasia had risked everything and borrowed from the future to raise arms to fight off Ibra.
Jurl saw no point in dying when he could not stop the prophet's armsmen and lancers, Jex
said dryly.
I don't think we'll restore his title or his duties, and especially not his exemption from paying the Leetgeld, Anna said.
There has always been a Lord of the Western Marches.
There may be again, Anna conceded, but not anyone that slippery. She looked meaningfully at the pile of scrolls. We have a few other matters to discuss.
I feared such.
Anna wanted to laugh at the rueful tone of his voice. Instead, she nodded. So do I. But remember, you thought my being regent was a good idea.
My life was simpler before I thought so much.
Anna did laugh before she picked up the next scroll. She jotted down a quick note on the back of a used piece of parchment to talk to Menares about sending a scroll to Gatrun about the young Chandler and learning his name. At times, especially when she returned to Falkor from somewhere, she wondered if she would ever be able to juggle all the problems. 9. Asaria Nazaria. The workroom is large, light, and airy. Dark woods ranging from flat planks to narrow timbers are stacked against one of the inner walls. A woodworker's bench is set out from the other inner wall, and on that set of wooden shelves beside the bench are set planes, chisels, saws, clamps, wood knives, several jars with stoppers, clean rags, and other implements. Three dark circular frames fill much of the open floor space. Each is man-high, and a stocky but bent and gray-haired man carefully smooths a rib of the frame closest to the door. The door opens, revealing that the outside is guarded by two of the prophet's guards. The craftsman steps back from the frame on which he was working and straightens, waiting. The prophet Rabin steps into the workroom, followed by an older Mansouran officer who accompanies him. Rabin pauses by the smooth and polished frame. His fingers caress the nearly black wood before his eyes go to the gray-haired craftsman, who glances from the young prophet to Nubara.
"You know what I want?"
demands the youth.
"Yes, most honored prophet. I have studied the scrolls you gave me, and I will do as they show."
The crafter gestures to the three frames.
"These are to the requirements of the scrolls."
"There must be no imperfections. Do you understand?"
"There will be none, honored sire. None at all."
The woodworker lowers his head.
"Good."
Rabin studies the second frame and then the third. With an abrupt nod, he turns and departs. Nubara follows hurriedly. The door closes and the two walk along the outer corridor back toward the columned audience chamber. The Mansouran officer glances from Rabin back toward the guarded door.
"How do you know he will do as you say?" "He has a daughter, Nubara. Right now she is in the South Villa. With her mother." "Her mother?"
Nubara frowns.
"Of course. That way he will know that no one has abused her."
Rabin's laugh is cold.
"I have not touched either. No one has. She is not that attractive, but he does not know that. Besides, I could turn her over to the lowest of the Westfell's foot, and he knows that. Or..."
Rabin smiles, and his face appears almost serpent-like.
"I could think of something." "Yet you will reward him if he builds these devices." "Even I know, Nubara, that a ruler must keep his promises."
A second laugh follows.
"You might notice how few I make, and how careful I am with my words."
Rabin looks toward the audience chamber.
"The glass has come for me to appear concerned and caring for the welfare of my people."
He lifts his eyebrows.
"Are you ready?" "Yes, honored prophet."
Rabin does not look at the Mansouran officer before stepping through the door that a servant has opened for him. Behind him, Nubara shivers, then follows. 10. Anna stepped out of the receiving room and nodded at the two guards, Lejeune and Rickle.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.